LNAV and LPV. It can be complicated to find your way. There are so many options. So, inside your cockpit, you may have some questions. What are the differences between all these approach types? What will ATC propose? And how can I fly it? During this presentation, I propose to make a time travel. Time travel through the history of flight without visibility, from the beginning in the 20s to now. In fact, I will review all these approach types available through the history of flight without visibility. Let's start in the 20s with the first airline, when the first airline was created, and began to grow the need to fly by night. In France, the Latéco airline for mail delivery from Toulouse to South America was the first to use aeronautical lighthouse to help the pilot to navigate by night. In fact, it was the first navettes available. In 1929, Jimmy Doolittle was the first person to perform a total flight without visibility, just using instruments. And we see that in the 30s, new means were created to help the pilot. ILS, GONIO, NDB, and VOR was created to bring electronic means to the pilot in order to localize itself and help for the landing. And in 1938, the first ILS approach was created. Up to the 70s, there was only Xavier says earlier, there was only navettes to locate itself, DME, VOR, and ILS. In fact, there was no complex system on board, only receivers of data coming from ground navettes. The approaches were divided in two categories. The precision approaches, where a vertical guidance is proposed, so the well-known ILS, and the non-precision approaches, when there is no vertical guidance provided, so the classical navettes, VOR, or DME, or NDB. The revolution really occurs in the 80s, with a new generation of aircraft, with a new system on board, the flight management system, and the inertial reference systems. Thanks to this new system, it has been possible to have access to the aircraft position and to display it on a moving map, on the navigation display on the cockpit. It has also been possible to have access to the distance to threshold. So it could be very useful now to check the altitude distance to localize itself on the vertical plan. It also allows the creation of the AirNav concept, area navigation. In fact, this is the possibility to create waypoints whenever you want, not based on a ground navette, so just by their coordinates. And it's also possible to be guided from a waypoint to another waypoint thanks to a lateral guidance on a defined flight plan, and the procedures are now coded in a navigation database loaded inside the system. And it also finally proposes a vertical guidance in barometric based on a vertical profile defined in the FMS. The CDFA concept was there born, CDFA for Continuous Descent Final Approach. But it is a barometric guidance, but it is really what can say it's a non-board landing system without the use of ground reference. In the 90s, the improvement came from the space. The GPS constellation is now fully serviceable and operative, and it brings a new position, the GPS position, with an accuracy, a certain accuracy, and an integrity. An integrity is an accuracy with a higher level of trust. For example, when all is operative in an aircraft, in a GPS with a GPS position, the accuracy is around 20 meters, and the integrity is around 0.1 nautical miles, so 180 meters. Thanks to this integrity parameter and accuracy parameter, it has been possible to create the PBN concept, performance-based navigation. You all heard about that, about PBN, RNP, And there were several presentations on that previously in a previous symposium, so I will not enter into the detail now. We talked earlier about the getting to grips with RNPR that will be modified. In fact, we will create a getting to grips with performance-based navigation. So it will include RNPR, but also other PBN operation, and also explaining the concept of PBN and so on. So as Dominique told you earlier, this getting to grips will be available in July. In fact, it's technically finished. We are just publishing it. Today, I will only focus on the approaches, on AirNav GNSS approaches, and on AirNav RNP, also known as RNP Air. So first, AirNav GNSS. It is an AirNav procedure, so waypoint can be created wherever you want. They are not linked on ground navets. In addition, there is a required performance that is asked for this procedure. The required value is 0.3 nautical miles between the final straight leg, between the FAF and the missed approach point, and 1 nautical miles elsewhere, so in initial, intermediate, and missed approach segment. You can have various types of minima for this kind of operation. You can have LNAV-only minima. In this case, the obstacle clearance is performed the same way that for a classical NAVED procedure, in VOR or NDB procedure. So the monitoring of your vertical profile regarding obstacle clearance is the same that for a normal NPA, non-precision approach. So using the cross-check altitude distance. In fact, you will also use the fact that there is some step-down fix. So you will check the altitude crossing the step-down fixes. If the minima is LNAV-VNAV, in this case, the obstacle clearance is now based on a defined profile. So the monitoring will also be based on this defined profile, coded inside your FMS, and you just will have to monitor the vertical deviation. There is also another minima, which is the LPV minima. I will come back later. Now let's talk about AirNav RNP, the other operation that was created at this time, well known as RNP-AR. RNP-AR offers the ultimate solution for procedure designer because we have a lot of flexibility that has been added. The possibility to perform turn after the FAF, the possibility to have low RNP value down to 0.1 nautical miles, and the fact that the protection area, has the margin has been reduced. So it allows to have a lot of design flexibility, and it was created especially for mountainous area, terrain in a remote area, in mountainous area. The first RNP air procedure was created in 1997 in Juneau in Alaska, and we see that in the beginning, in the 20s, this new century, there was other airports that has been created with RNPR procedure, like Queenstown in New Zealand, or Lhasa or Lindsay in China, or Vaga in Faroe Island. All these locations can have now more accessibility thanks to RNPR procedures. But we see that now the use is changing and there is more and more RNPAR procedure outside the mountainous area around big airports. I will come back on this later. AirNav RNP and also AirNav GNSS are considered as classified as non-precision approaches, even if we have a quite precise position in laterally thanks to the GPS use, the vertical guidance is in barometric. So now let's move to this new century and talk about a new concept introduced, which is the differential GPS. The goal of this new functionality is to enhance the accuracy and the integrity of the GPS position, and especially using reference stations. And it also allows to have access to a precise GPS altitude. So it's as precise that we can perform a vertical geometrical guidance. Two solutions were created, the GBAS for ground-based augmentation system and the SBAS for satellite-based augmentation system. First, let's talk about GBAS. In fact, how it works, a reference station on ground and the aircraft receives the data from the GNSS constellation. The reference station in the vicinity of the airport knows its exact position and can compute a difference. This data is sent via VHF to the aircraft. And with this differential data, the aircraft can compute a GPS-augmented position, including vertically. Other data are transmitted. It's a final approach segment data, which are the anchor point coordinates, the course, and the slope. And thanks to this data, the MMR inside the aircraft can compute a virtual beam identical to an ILS beam, a geometrical virtual beam, and the aircraft can be guided as an ILS using glide slope and lock mode. It is to notice that one GBAS installation can provide information for various runways with a different channel, and that's why we can have more and more GBAS initiatives because there is less cost than putting an ILS facility at each runway end. It is to notice that GLS is considered as a precision approach, like the ILS, and is charted as GLS. Now let's talk about SBAS. It's easy, it works the same way, but it is not one reference station on ground near the airport. It is a network of reference stations that also receive the data, that also compute differential position. The data is not sent via VHF, but via a geostationary satellite. Thanks to this data, it works the same way. The aircraft will receive it via geostationary satellite, compute an augmented position. The final approach segment data are not transmitted. They are directly coded inside the navigation database. And the same way, the MMR will compute a geometrical virtual beam. And the same way, can be flown as an ILS. But the difference comes from how it is charted. SBAS approaches are charted as AirNav GNSS with LPV minima, which means that it is classified as a non-precision approach. But we see that the angular protection is the same as an ILS or a GLS. The vertical guidance is geometric, and the minima can be as low as 200 feet, so equivalent to Cat 1. So, okay, it is classified as a non-precision approach, but as you see, clearly the characteristic of a precision approach, it's just a name, it's just a classification. You have to consider it like a precision approach. So now, you know the theory, all these approach types. You know what are the different approaches. But what will ATC will propose you when you will come from landing? First, the ILS. ILS is still the first choice, and it will stay the first choice for a long time. I will not enter into the detail or how it works or how can you fly it, because it's your daily operation to have ILS approaches. Can also be cleared for a GLS approach when the airport is equipped and when your aircraft is also equipped with that. As you see in this chart, there is more and more GBAS initiative all around the world. You can see a map of last year, for example, there will be half points, the half of all this initiative. There is more and more initiative because GBAS can save cost for airport infrastructure. For Airbus aircraft, the GBAS capability is managed by a dedicated SB available on S380, S350, S330, and S320. It requests a specific MMR, and we have the Cat 1 autoland capability. It works clearly the same than an ILS. Same SOPs, same way to select the approach and so on. And it is to notice that we are working with our MMR manufacturer with ground facilities to have a CAT3 autoland capability in the future. But it is studies for the moment. When you are not, where a precision approach is not available, for example, in case of ILS maintenance and so on, you will be, I'm sure, clear for NERNAV GNSS approaches. This type of approach is replacing all non-precision approaches based on ground navets. More and more, there is NERNAV GNSS approaches. You will have the opportunity to reach LNAV VNAV minima. In this case, you will need to use vertical managed mode and so on. And you can reach also LNAV only minima. In this case, we recommend you to use the vertical management as advisory guidance. Maxime will make a presentation later on this, talking about the guidance mode that you can use in this case. This guidance mode has a well-known final APP mode available since long time on Airbus aircraft, and the quite new FLS, FMS landing system, which is an ILS lookalike mode based on barometric. Regulation in place for AirNav GNSS are the EASA, is the EASA ANC 2027 for LNAV only and LNAV VNAV minima. As all PBN operations, the compliance is indicated in the AFM when your aircraft is capable. And all Airbus aircraft equipped with a GPS are capable of this kind of operation. There is a limitation on S300 for the moment, S300 on an A310. Is limited to LNAV only, but we are working to have also a BaroVNAV capability. For the moment, you need to do an OPS approval for this kind of operation, but it will be removed in a future EASA regulation. In fact, in future EASA regulations, there will be no more OPS approval requested for all PBN operations except RNPR. If you want to reach LPV minima, the Airbus solution for SBAS capability is the SLS function. This function is available on S350 via a dedicated SB, and it's under feasibility study for S320. There is a dedicated regulation, AMC 2028, and as for the other, compliance is indicated in the AFM, and an operational approval is needed, but it will be removed. You can also finish by an RNP AR procedure. As I told you earlier, it was initially for remote area in mountainous region. Now the usage changes because the design flexibility that offers this kind of operation can have a lot of advantage in congested TMA, so for traffic reasons, also for nose-sensitive area avoidance, and also for track mile saving. As we see in this chart, it's an approach in Seattle, and we see that we can have the benefit for the airline of a shortcut to have track mile saving, and also the benefit for the control to have a parallel approach with the ILS on the other side, so to face traffic congestion. Regulation in place are the EASA MC 2026, and FAA AC 90101A. The compliance is also indicated in the AFM when the aircraft is capable. The capability is managed by a dedicated SB, available on S320, S330, and S380, and the capability is basic on S350. And of course, it requests an operational approval, which is specific. And it can be quite significant if it is for a remote area when you have to create your procedure, but it can also be light if it is for traffic reasons. For example, going in the US where more than 400 RNP AR procedures have been created for traffic reasons. So, ladies and gentlemen, to conclude, you now know all the different types of approaches. You know what LTC will propose, so ILS first, precision approach first, so ILS or GLS if there is a GBAS initiative and your aircraft is capable. Otherwise, an NAV GNSS sure will be proposed to you. And we are working on the future on NAV GNSS with LPV minima and the SBAS capability. So now, one question remaining. How can I find this approach? For this one, I will let the scene to Captain Xavier Leceux for some tips about non-precision approaches, and after to Maxime Lansonner for SOPs on non-precision approaches. Thank you.